Welcome, and thank you for joining us in this very special program about Middlesex Community College. It is one of Bedford's greatest assets. We share it with Lowell because there are two campuses, but there is a new president as of October 15th. His name is Dr. James Mabry. He is a Bedford resident and president of Middlesex Community College. Welcome, Dr. Mabry.
Thank you very much. It's a real pleasure to be here.
Well, no, for us as well. You came from all different kinds of places. I'm just going to put my glasses on so I don't get this wrong. You were a high school social studies teacher in New York.
That's correct, yes.
Right in the city. And
that's where I started out, yeah. I taught first in the Bronx and then at a high school in Manhattan.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
What is it like to teach in a high school in Manhattan?
You learn classroom management skills very quickly.
I guess you would.
Okay. We'll do a separate program on what that might mean.
But more seriously, you learn how to work with diverse student bodies, and that was really critical for me. I learned a lot about working with students from very different backgrounds and from many, many different walks of life.
And that's serving you well all through your career.
Absolutely.
Because you've gone on to work with a community college in Dutchess County in Poughkeepsie.
Yes. I took a one-semester job there just after I finished my PhD and knew I was home. That was it.
And how long did that one semester last?
8 years there.
Okay, that's good.
Yeah.
And your department chair came to speak at your inauguration, didn't he?
George Stevens came.
Wow.
He was my original department chair who hired me. And I always say that George raised me right.
I think he did.
He really taught me, you know, he really helped me become a really good classroom teacher and work really well with community college students, but also was instrumental in showing me that there was a way to be a real professional and be engaged in the life of the college. That you could, you know, you could do a lot more. Once you got your teaching down, then it was time to branch out and really get involved in the life of the college. And he was really important in showing me how the college worked and where I could make a difference.
Well, it's quite clear that you did, because then you went on to Palm Beach State and Mesa, part of the Maricopa system.
Yes.
Out in Arizona.
Mm-hmm.
And then you got here.
Yes.
What made this an attractive opportunity for you?
A number of factors. First, I would say that, you know, Middlesex just has a great reputation. It's a community college that's been a very strong institution for a long time. It's been long recognized as a leader in the Massachusetts community college system. And there was real continuity and great leadership with Carol Cowan.
That's true, and you're just the fourth person to sit in that chair.
Yes. And, you know, Dr. Cowan built, you know, both campuses, really,
right.
And was really instrumental in making the community college what it is today. And she's, you know, been a great mentor for me.
And the response of the college to the community is just powerful.
Yes, yeah. Well, that's really part of who we are. And I would say that's another thing that really attracted me. Both campuses are deeply involved in the communities, that they work very closely. You know, I almost need to keep a spreadsheet of all the different ways we're connected with the communities. There's so many different things going on. It really is good. And I think also my wife and I really enjoy the culture in the Northeast and are happy to be back here.
And we're delighted that you're here.
Thank you.
We're absolutely delighted that you're here. So we've talked a little bit about your professional background,
mm-hmm.
but it seems to me in reading the things that I now know a little bit more about you as an individual, that you're an extremely well-placed individual to work with community college students.
Wow.
Because you had a somewhat unique educational career yourself when you were a student.
I was, I didn't start out on the career path to be a college president.
Had you originally thought you
this
might
stuff
do?
Is
I barely made it out of high school. That was the first struggle, you know?
That's great.
You know, and I always joked that I couldn't get into a state university in New York coming out of high school, and so I went to Ohio. That was what the guidance counselor said. It's easier to get in there.
Oh, yes, so, you're an East Coast transplant.
Right.
Yes, they love them from the East Coast.
So, you know, I went to Ohio, and actually I was on a swimming scholarship at the time and swam, and that was good. I mean, it was a lot of work. You learn a lot about discipline, working that hard and getting your studies done. But I was still a rather confused young man at that time, and I always say dropping out was the best decision I ever made.
Well, it took you to a long way away.
It did. I mean, I worked for a year, you know, and saved all my money, and then decided I wanted to travel a little bit. And I set off on a 2-month adventure in Europe, and I came home 4 years later. So you just never know where it's going to take you.
So
plus, you went to college while you were in Europe, too.
I did take some evening courses. Yep. I was working for about 3.5 of those 4 years for the Air Force. And I took some courses on Air Force bases. And I remember the University of Maryland counselor saying, you know, if you took a social science, we could give you an AA degree here. So I have that hanging in my office today. My
fantastic.
AA degree from University of Maryland Overseas Division.
Wherever it comes from. And does that not speak to the person rather than the diploma?
Well, it was just keeping interested in learning. I've always, you know, been very interested in, mm-hmm. in learning, and that was a way to continue to be actively reading and discussing books and taking courses. I took a couple language courses so I could function better in, you know, traveling throughout Europe. But it just was a good way to keep active.
You know, there are a fair number of community leaders right here in Bedford that started out at the junior college or community
right.
college level,
mm-hmm.
and they say, if it wasn't for that community college, I wouldn't be where
sure.
I am today.
Right.
And absolutely.
So you're the right person with the right, working with the right people.
And lest you think that Dr. Mabry just came from the University of Maryland's extension to Bedford. He has a bachelor's from the Columbia School of General Studies, a master's in science from the London School of Economics, and his PhD in history from Columbia. So you kind of got back on the academic track in a big way.
I'm still trying to figure out why Columbia let me in.
Right.
They knew a good thing when they saw one.
You know, they have the School of General Studies is very interesting. It's the undergraduate college for non-traditional students at Columbia. And it started after World War II to serve the population on the GI Bill.
Yep.
And has gone through several different iterations over the years. And it has a different application process and a different support system, but now you take the same classes. So I went back there at 26. I went to Columbia from a construction crew and was sitting in courses with the 19 and 20-year-olds who'd never had a job before. And it was a fascinating experience, and one that made me work very, very hard. I really had to raise my game, and it was really relying on that ability to work hard and to take care of myself that I was able to move to New York City not knowing anybody there and really go to school and be successful. But it was a real hard grind in the beginning to, you know, really become a proficient learner at the level required at an elite institution like Columbia.
Well, that's almost the same as the students we have at Middlesex.
Mm-hmm.
They're coming from all sorts of different directions at different ages.
Absolutely, yeah. And I actually had two students from Mesa Community College in Arizona go to Columbia, to the School of General Studies. And one just graduated in May, and he's applying to graduate schools now. So he's working in a lab at the university, and he really did very well there. He tells a great story of taking 6 years to get his 2-year degree.
Yeah.
Sometimes it takes.
It's fine.
And then he just went right through. And
yeah.
We find that those students who come in and really get motivated at the community college, get involved in things like our honors program, they really can go anywhere. And that's the message, you know, I use my own story to say, you're a lot better positioned than I was, and you really could do this.
Well, and the idea of having you in the president's chair saying that and making sure, they tell me that part of your mission for a community college is opening our doors to every student.
Mm-hmm.
And what better message?
Yeah. I mean, I worked with another student out in Arizona he came to the college at 26 years old. He'd been working in restaurants since high school. He'd never taken a course at college level. 2 years later, he's calling me up saying, Dr. Mabry, I'm turning down the offer from Columbia because he'd gotten in a better program at University of Illinois. And 4 years from walking in our door, he's in a PhD program in robotics and the top 5 program in the United States. So you don't know what's walking in your door. And we have students here all the time who really don't understand what they could do. Half our students are first generation. They don't have that background, and they really don't know what they're capable of. Just this weekend, I was writing a recommendation letter for a student. He's an immigrant from Guatemala who's learned English, he's in our honors program, he's in the Paul Sullivan Leadership Institute, and he wants to go through and go to medical school.
You never know.
He's doing really, really well. And he's just a charming individual. You know, he's really focused, he really works hard, he has a job at the college, but he's a real nice kid too. You know, he's always helping other students. So, you know, I try to take those kids aside and say, you could go anywhere.
You know, I think the most important thing is, yeah, we have the curriculum and we go through all the skills the students need and they pick up most of the skills.
Sure.
But the most important part they learn is what the teacher models. Mm-hmm. And you as a model, I think, becomes a key part in the students at Middlesex.
Yeah, you try to motivate them and show them there are many ways. And that's the beauty
of
our education system. It is quite flexible. And that these students really have an opportunity to get there, no matter where they started.
Well, it's extraordinary. And you and your wife, after your inauguration, had a party that turned into quite a substantial asset for the college.
Yes.
That was and a nice welcome to town gift.
Yes, that was great fun. You know, my wife has been just a huge help all the way through this, and co-hosting a scholarship benefit reception with me was really a lot of fun to do. And we raised over $36,000 at that reception for student scholarships. So.
Congratulations.
And you were just brand new on the job.
Brand new on the job.
Well, the future is great.
We really hope to build that up so that we can leave, you know, when we're finished here, that we can leave an endowed scholarship mm-hmm. that'll carry on and really support students for a long time.
Oh, boy, is Bedford lucky to have you. So you had quite the day on your inauguration.
It was a lot of fun. It started out with a 5K road race.
Oh, that,
right?
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's one of the reasons I said that, because...
Yep.
I don't think I know of any, I don't know many college presidents. Let's get right down to that. But to start your inauguration, I mean, my vision is, it's my inauguration. I've got to get my nails done. I've got to get my hair, you know, a lot of self-prep. Yeah. But you were out there running and had a lot of people with you.
Right. The part I'm not over yet is that my younger daughter beat me, and she won't let me forget that. But we had a lot of fun running together, and George Stevens was out there running. He's been a runner for many years, and we had a lot of fun. And it didn't take me long to get the hair done that day.
There you go. And it looked terrific.
Thank you.
Absolutely terrific. Absolutely outstanding. Yeah. So you've got fitness on your background. Mm-hmm. You've got access for students and diversity.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, you know, I talked about, you know, working in a diverse urban public education system, and that's where I've always been attracted to, really working with diverse groups of students. And the community college is always the most diverse institution in a community.
They certainly are.
And that's where everybody comes, and it's not just diversity by, you know, race and ethnicity. It's really by ability, background, age. You know, experience, and we get such a huge range of students at the college that's, you know, really a wonderful asset. And you'll find that a lot of the mature students that are in our classrooms really help the younger students.
They really do.
Yeah. And the younger students will help the more mature ones with the technology. Everybody
the good new music.
Everybody has their skills, and it's really interesting to see how they work together to really become a cohesive learning unit in the classrooms. And so much of our learning these days is really about working together, about teamwork, team-based approach, project-based learning. And this is really important for mm-hmm. our students to learn, because in any workplace, you're going to be working with a diverse range of people. And that ability to work and learn and grow is really important.
Well, and with so many situations for children, particularly coming mm-hmm. through school right now, you have your third grade class. You see your third grade class. You hardly ever get to see the kids from fourth or fifth grade, mm-hmm. or second or fifth. You know, the ones on either side of three. anyhow, but that mix sometimes doesn't really happen. And then when you get into sports and extracurricular activities, you're a third grade girl, you go do softball with third grade girls. There's not a lot of, you know, necessarily interaction. And you're bringing people back to the modern and very sophisticated version of a one-room schoolhouse where everybody is helping everybody else.
Right? Yeah. Right.
So it's kind of coming around full circle and getting the very best out of that.
Yes. Yeah. I think also because we have a wide range of curriculum, we offer over 70 programs, mm-hmm. and so we have students coming in with a lot of different interests. So the majority of our students come because they want to transfer. You know, they're really coming to get their first 2 years of gen ed courses and then transfer to a university. That's about 60% of our students. So they're really seeing us as a great place to start. You know, we have small classrooms, we have dedicated teaching professionals. Our professors really are the people who know their subject material, but they love working with students. They're not researchers, they're teachers. And this is what they focus on. And they really work hard on their pedagogy. But also we have small classes. We don't have big lecture halls. Our average class size is about 23. And we really do focus on being very much there for our students, providing those personal support services, and really helping them find their place in an educational institution. And it doesn't matter what age that is. And you know, the other part, we have a big chunk of people who are coming back to school to go to,
pick up other courses.
They may only need two accounting courses to help their business, or they may really want to be coming back and then transferring and going on. A lot of people come back after raising families and get their bachelor's degree after going to Middlesex. So we're there for everybody.
The ranges are fantastic. Mm-hmm. And I think my wife Jean and I sponsored a student from Nepal. Mm-hmm. The support she got, not knowing the language all that well and all that, through the support system mm-hmm. that you have, phenomenal for the
right.
starting learner.
Right.
Another one of her students, she teaches there
yep.
as well,
mm-hmm.
has a PhD.
Right.
And
yep.
I thought, wow, you had a PhD in your class? Oh, yeah.
yeah.
So see, that there's a future for you yet.
Right.
Well, the Middlesex training that...
She wanted to change her career.
Well, no. Yeah. I was thinking of mind blank.
Yeah.
Your student from Nepal
is
a dental person in Nepal now,
and she got into the dental program.
She went through the dental hygienist program.
Yes,
yeah, that's a very rigorous program.
It really is.
Yeah.
Well, and now she's bringing good dental care to Nepal.
Yeah. Sure,
yep.
absolutely.
To her patients.
Yeah. And your school was fantastic.
So that's the other big group is students who come for 2 years in a degree program that really will get them a career.
Yep.
So it could be dental hygiene, dental technician, nursing.
Yep.
Right. Also, we do things like cybersecurity, and we also do biotechnology. Now, in our biotechnology program, wonderful program, very rigorous. Students take 4 semesters of biology, 2 semesters of chemistry. They really have a sound grounding in biological sciences. We have 100% placement rate for those students. They get snapped up by the pharmaceutical industry. I mean, the pharmaceutical industry needs the PhDs from the UMass system, but they also need our students to run the labs, to run the research, to do all that work there. But these students all want to end up being researchers.
Yeah.
They all get their 2-year degree and they tell me that they're just going to get a job so that they can pay for the next degree.
They're very ambitious. You have a wonderful niche that you're getting there. With Bishnu, she got back to Kathmandu, got a job in 4 days.
Yeah. Through those programs, you will find the students find jobs very quickly. And, you know, you see a lot of, you know, frontline service providers within the community are coming out of there. We run a police academy.
That's a super one.
And do a lot of different things there. So a lot of people get trained at the community college.
Outstanding. What would you like the community in Bedford to know either about you or about the college that we haven't talked about?
I would rather have them learn about the college. Right? It really is a wonderful place with a tremendous amount of programs, you know, for a whole range of people. I would say we start out working very closely with the high school system here, and we have been building the dual enrollment program.
And we'll learn more about that in this very program.
Right?
Stay
tuned. You'll learn more about that. And that really gives students a chance to really fast track their college education at a very affordable price. We have a Commonwealth Honors Program, so students can come in and take honor seminars and really have a rigorous academic experience. Go on, and we have students who've gone on to UMass Amherst every year in the Commonwealth Honors Program and really do fantastic things. But also we have a lot of community programming as well. So we have the Miles program.
I was just going to ask if that's running again this year.
Miles is always running because it's well attended, and that's a program for us mature adults, so we can all keep learning. Yes, and it's a non-credit lecture-based program, and we have some very interesting speakers lined up for that this year. But we also have a big health and wellness expo coming up on March 30th, I think it is. And this is opportunities for people to come to campus, really learn about healthy lives, get screenings for many things, and find out how they can better take care of themselves. And if you want to join us, we can sometimes go out and for a walk on our 1.5 mile trail system.
There you go. In colder, snowier winters, there have been skating parties.
On the
pond. With s'mores and hot chocolate. Yeah.
Oh, great. Wonderful. So, and also you will hear from Carmen Rodriguez Peralta about the music series.
That's an amazement. Right. Those concerts, you're going to hear
the
more.
The jazz ones are really good.
Right.
Well, every last one of them, they're often, I shouldn't say they're often, well, I guess maybe often is a good word to use. Bedford Television tapes many of them.
Right.
And so you can see them on Bedford Television, but there's nothing better than going out on a Friday night and hearing live music here in Bedford.
In a nice small concert hall.
A beautiful space, and it's free.
Yes.
You just walk in and say, hi, I'm here. It's amazing. It's absolutely
and we just
amazing.
Put new lights in there, so that'll help the recordings of it. And and we're looking at putting in some new seating in there too.
So. One of the advantages about Middlesex that I never realized till Pishna was going through, the tuition at Middlesex is less than the tuition at University of Lowell, but there's an automatic transfer that they can take their classes at Middlesex and save some money and then transfer.
Yes. We're a little less than half.
Oh, really? Okay. That much?
And it's really considerably less, yes. So it really is a great deal and really works out well for students to take the first 2 years and then transfer.
Well, it is a big blessing and a bonus to Bedford that you are here.
Yeah, we are thrilled you're here and living in town, too.
Welcome. So now we know what your first 6 months have been. Mm-hmm. Will you come back again in the fall and tell us about your first, we'll look back at your first year?
I'd love to.
Oh.
That'd
We'd
be great.
We'd like that a lot.
That'd be wonderful.
We'd like that a lot.
It's been, a busy time, but very rewarding. And I have to say the community's made me feel very welcome. And I've really enjoyed becoming a resident in this wonderful community.
Well, we're delighted to have you. Thank you so much. Our guest has been Dr. James Mabry, who is the president of Middlesex Community College. But don't go away, because we have more about Middlesex. We have Carmen Rodriguez Peralta, who has for several years now been doing a World of Music concert program. And we will also be talking about dual enrollment at Middlesex and at Bedford High School. So
we've got good stuff.
We've got good stuff. Thank you
Dr. Mabry.
Thanks for having me. It's a pleasure.
Hey, look at Mommy.
Maybe the light hurts his eyes.
Maybe she's just not hungry.
Look.
Maybe it's a phase.
Avoiding eye contact is one early sign of autism. Learn the others today.
Thank you for staying with us. I'm still Julie Turner. This is still Ralph Hammond. But this is no longer President Mabry. This is Carmen Rodriguez Peralta, who has for how many years, Carmen, been doing World of Music?
World of Music started in 2001. So now we're in its 15th season. And we had concerts before that also. So our first concert at Middlesex was 1989.
Wow.
Yeah, I was 10 years old.
Wow. Have you been there the whole time?
I've been there the whole time, yes.
Wow.
Well, what you have to know, or I should say you have to know, but what I would like for you to know is that the World of Music concerts are in two seasons, fall and spring. The programs are amazing, and they're free.
They're free,
on the Bedford campus. There are some on Lowell, too, but the ones on the Bedford campus are brilliant. Carmen, how did you come to decide to have concerts in Bedford?
Well, I started out, like I said, in 1989, and a friend of mine from the Boston Symphony, Luis Leguia, and I were doing lots of concerts together. And so I thought it'd be really nice if we would play at the college. And so a lot of people said, well, no one's going to come hear a classical cellist, and of course we filled the hall. And so we had concerts like once or twice a year, and then it became clear we needed a real series where we could bring guest artists and student performers, and more faculty members were joining the music department. And so that's why we started a World of Music concert series in 2001. Well,
and so it is a reflection of the department
in
some
way.
Ways.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, so and the audience, of course.
And I bet that the world might be surprised to hear that there is such a very active music department at Middlesex.
We have a large department now.
Can you tell us a little bit about it?
We have two full-time people, myself and Johanna Segerich, who's a wonderful mezzo, and then we have 11 adjuncts, and they're all either performers or composers. So we have five composers on our faculty at the moment. Last year we had an MCC composers concert, and all five of them had compositions that were featured. We used to have a violinist, violist until recently. We're going to have a flutist next year. We have several singers, percussionists, like I say, composers, pianists, guitarists.
That's the staff. Now, for students, can you tell us a little bit about your students?
We do. We have a music major, and a lot of people take music classes who aren't music majors. We have over 600 students taking music classes per year, which is actually quite a fair number, I think.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So only a few of those are music majors. So most people take it because they've always wanted to play in a world drumming ensemble, or they want to take music appreciation. So we have this kind of dual role of just opening up our classes to anyone who wishes to take music classes, as well as training people who wish to transfer as music majors.
Well, and you have quite a, if I remember correctly, you have a couple people teaching piano and...
Yes.
Yeah.
So we have a variety of survey classes, like music appreciation, world music, American music, that kind of thing. And then we have theory courses. And then we have composition as an independent study, voice as an independent study, guitar as an independent study, as well as classes, voice classes, guitar classes, piano classes. So people can come in many different levels and
well,
get something
and
out
of some it. Well, and some of the voice students, we heard one of your sopranos at President Mabry's inauguration.
Right, she's a faculty member.
Okay.
Oh, really?
Yes. Anna Ward. She's a faculty member.
Well, and she was spectacular.
Right.
She was absolutely wonderful.
Well, she sings in opera. She's a very active performer outside of the college, which a lot of us are. A lot of us do perform a lot outside, as well as in the college.
And some of you have wonderful CDs that...
Weren't you nice?
No. It actually is one of my very favorite things, and it is... the result of your study into a woman composer from...
Venezuela.
I was just going to say Guatemala.
Yes.
Oh,
Venezuela.
Really?
South America.
Yeah.
How did you find her and focus on her? And this is not what Carmen came here to say. We're supposed to be talking about the program. But you've got to know that this is probably one of my favorite...
Oh, thank you. How nice to
CDs.
Hear that.
It is good music.
Hmm. So and unusual music,
it
too.
It is unusual. And so a woman performer and a woman composer.
Right, from the 19th century. And a very, very glamorous woman and dramatic life also.
I love it. I do indeed. Well, we should probably get to what we're supposed to be talking about. Who's going to be in this year's spring concert series, which begins on April 1st?
Yes. For some reason, nobody wanted to play in February. I can't imagine why. After last winter, people said no February, no March, so all of our concerts are in April and May.
And
how many concerts are there?
We have six.
Six?
Yeah, two student recitals and then four other recitals.
And the four are in Bedford and then this... Well,
no, there's three. There's three in Bedford and then there's one, the Cambodian concert is in Lowell.
I think we're going to need to get a bus to go up there. Yeah. Tell us about the first concert.
The first one is Anglo-American duo. So we have a British... British pianist and American violinist, and they are coming. They play all over England as well as the United States, and they have a really interesting program that focuses on a British composer, David Osborne, who happens to be the husband of the pianist.
Okay.
And so they're performing a piece of his called Five Hommages. So there are five different composers that influence this composition, and then they're performing pieces by three of those composers. So Beethoven, Messiaen, and Elgar. So it should be really interesting.
It should. I think we've got to find.
Okay.
All right, that's April 1st.
Okay, yep. And that's not going to be an April Fool's joke.
No,
that's
going to
be a serious event. That's going to be wonderful.
Yeah, it should be really interesting.
And then?
Then we have three guitarists, and they're coming April 9th, and one of them is our own Adam Levin, who is a wonderful guitarist, and he's bringing two of his friends, equally good classical guitarists. They'll be performing a program of wonderful pieces for solo guitar, two guitars, three guitars by Villa-Lobos and other Brazilian composers, some from Spain, one Takamitsu from Japan. We have one from, some from Spain, so a variety program should be really interesting.
Outstanding, and that one is going to be on, that's almost...
That's Saturday, April 9th.
Yep, so kind of clunk clank.
Right, everybody wanted April, like I say. No snow, so everybody just said...
And
April's good.
Well, let's hope April is good. With the February weather we're having, we may catch up in April.
That's
we don't
true.
Want to do
That's
that.
True.
So then, on the 17th, you are going to bid farewell to Johanna Segrich.
Yes, that's a sad event for me. She is a very long-time, full-time faculty member. I've been here for 24 years, both as an adjunct and a full-time member. Wonderful mezzo-soprano. Equally wonderful teacher. She is responsible for the outreach program we have in Lowell. She is the person, the head of Strings for Cambodia, our fundraising program. She had numerous grants to work with the Cambodian community. We'll really miss her. But she's retiring, so that's
well,
good for her.
Well, it's kind of, yes, that is the inexorable progression of life. So the Cambodian Strings for Cambodia program, and then you're going to have your Cambodian concert on the 30th.
Right, but actually this concert is the fundraiser for Strings for Cambodia.
Okay.
The farewell to Johanna on the 17th, which will be in Bedford.
Okay.
And so a lot of us faculty members will be serenading her, and she will be performing also.
Be fun.
She doesn't escape it, so she gets to sing.
All right.
So she'll be singing duets with our sopranos and with a lovely trio we're going to do with Johanna singing, excuse me, and flute and piano.
So wonderful, really outstanding. But then people should bring their checkbooks, and you're going to tell us just a tiny bit about Strings for Cambodia.
Okay. Yep. So Strings for Cambodia is a fundraising program that was begun by Johanna Segrich. Excuse me, could I take a break a minute?
Sure.
So what's going to happen?
Would you like a little drink?
That might be good. Yeah.
Okay. Just put the thing on hold for a minute and get a small drink of water. Would that be possible?
I think it's the lights or something. I don't know, the heat or the...
It's pretty dry in here.
I'm choking up here. Talking about Johanna, as it made me choke.
There you go.
Back of the throat sounds.
No, it's all of a sudden, guys, it's really dry in here.
And that.
Then we'll pick up with strings. I can also have a cough drop, but that's not very nice to be chomping on a cough drop while you're talking.
Well, there's water back there.
Water should be fine.
They'll find it. There we go.
Great one together.
Thank you very much.
Should have thought of that.
Well, and we sometimes do, and it just didn't occur to me, and I apologize for that.
That's right. We'll have our Bedford TV mugs just
Well, there you go.
GBH. They have their GBH mugs, and every now and then they mug for the camera, no pun intended. Thank you so
there
much.
You go. All right.
Good.
So we've taken a minute or so for that, and we'll just go over by a minute.
I'll get back
or so.
Here.
Yeah, if you could just re-ask the question.
Yeah.
Wait a minute. Let's try this again.
Starting over. Can you tell us a little bit about Strings for Cambodia, please?
Certainly. So this was a fundraising program begun by Johanna Segrich as a result of a trip that she took to Cambodia as part of Fulbright Hayes scholarship that she had. And so she was talking to the director of the main conservatory there, Rufa, and asked what we could do for them. And she kind of expected the answer to be more how to bring Cambodian music to the U.S., and that was part of it. But he said he really wanted to start a Western classical orchestra in Cambodia, and he wanted really good Western string instruments for his students at the conservatory. And so they began chatting about this and discovered that the solution would be to use carbon fiber instruments, because of course they don't have the problems of the wood instruments.
Right,
and a lot of they're very light, right? And also they don't have to have air conditioning and temperature changes don't impact the instrument. So Johanna began this fundraising program called Strings for Cambodia. And so we have this this friend, Luis Leguia, friend of the college, the cellist from the Boston Symphony, who gave that very first concert with me in 1989. Mm-hmm. And he's the head of a company called Lewis and Clark and they manufacture carbon fiber instruments. So the idea is to raise money to send instruments, these wonderful carbon fiber instruments, from Lewis and Clark over to Cambodia.
That's a wonderful, innovative in so many different kinds of ways. So quick question, do we think that maybe in some time in the future we'll have the Cambodian students come with their carbon fiber instruments and play?
But we're still working on getting them over there.
Oh, okay.
Yes, we're still in that phase. So we're hoping to send the first violin over in June.
Are you networked with the Cambodian community in Lowell?
We do, yes. And also we have these fundraising concerts.
Wonderful.
Which we do that.
That's hugely exciting, And so then your Cambodian concert in Lowell is going to be pretty exciting too.
Right. Right.
Can you tell us a little bit about who is performing and what kind of music people can expect to hear?
Traditional Cambodian music. Song Heng is the performer. He's a master Cambodian musician. And this is part of interdisciplinary weekend that we have every semester. So we provide the music portion for that weekend. And so this weekend is devoted to Southeast Asia. And so we have this master Cambodian musician who's going to come and chat about different types of traditional music and play different types of percussion instruments. So a xylophone-like instrument and other instruments he will bring and chat with the students and the public about these instruments that I, for one, know very little about. So it should be really interesting.
Kind of like a petting zoo for the Cambodian instruments.
A little bit, but he's going to perform a lot also. Yeah. And he may bring some local musicians with him also to perform.
Outstanding.
Your outreach is to the general public, but do you have an outreach specifically to the high schools in the area?
We do. We have a music outreach program run by Johanna Segerich in Lowell. And we work with the Lowell High School as well as the Middlesex Charter School. And so we bring students from those schools to Bedford, to the college assembly room in the federal building. And then sometimes
in Lowell.
It's all in Lowell, yes.
And so then, is there a Bedford connection or is that?
No, it's really pretty much for the city of Lowell.
It would
yes.
be good to have a Bedford connection.
Okay,
we used to have one of the best music departments around.
Yeah. Well, can, that's
a goal. I would really like to see that happen. Mm-hmm. That would be
there
super.
You go. Well, you're in charge.
I'll do what I can.
Well, I do contact Bedford High School about these concerts, and often the students from there come. So that's kind of our connection to the concert series.
So they come to the concerts. But how about students from Bedford High? Have they entered?
They do sometimes come to the concerts also.
Yeah. Well, have they registered as students in your program?
We do have, yes, definitely.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So we get students from all the surrounding schools.
Right, and we'll be talking about dual enrollment. And
yes, that was another
nice segue.
Exactly, stay tuned. Carmen, thank you so much both for coming today and talking about the concert series, World of Music, and for getting it going in the first place so we have something to talk about.
Well, thank you so much for inviting me.
This is absolutely fantastic. Thank you for coming.
Thank you very much.
We will be back to talk about dual enrollment. And we're back. Our guest in this segment is someone whom you may, if you have young people in Bedford, know quite well. Her name is Ellen Grandine. And she runs the program at Middlesex that is in charge of making sure that kids who are in high school can take college courses as dual enrollment things. How did this come about? How did you get involved? How long? Just tell us everything you know.
All right. Dual enrollment at Middlesex Community College has been available for a while. I've been with the college for about a year. And in that time, we've been building our partnerships with area high schools. And Bedford High School got involved this year. And so we're offering courses right on campus at Bedford High School.
So nobody needs to travel.
That's right.
You're doing the traveling. How extraordinary.
Yes. And actually, our faculty are Bedford High School faculty. So.
Oh, really?
Yes. Yeah, so it's a partnership. So we work together to bring faculty mentors from Middlesex Community College to work directly with the high school faculty. And together, they align the curriculum and develop the courses. So students that are taking courses at Bedford High School are also earning credit at Middlesex Community College.
And they're full-time college courses?
Yes, yep.
Outstanding.
Wow.
So what are some of the topics?
So students, we recommend students take courses that are in line with the mass transfer block, and those are highly transferable courses
across
the
state. Those would be sort of standard history kinds
of
things?
So when you think about your freshman semester, English Composition 1, U.S. History, at Bedford High School, we're offering both Introduction to Psychology and Macro and Microeconomics.
Okay, now these are taught at the high school?
Yes, right at the high school.
Oh, wow.
Right on campus.
Can I go get into that microeconomics?
Well, you could get half your college done before you even leave Bedford High.
That's right, and that's the advantage. And the other piece that's really nice about it is that Middlesex has really committed to helping students, and so we have a reduced tuition rate for dual enrollment students as well.
Wow.
How long has this been going on?
You know, I don't have the full history of dual enrollment at Middlesex, but I would say it's been growing over the last several years. And it's a national initiative. We're really looking at partnerships and the trajectory of kindergarten through what we now refer to as grade 16. So that students are...
Oh, smart. Ooh.
Yeah, really working so that they can continue in their education when they're ready to move forward.
So this is going on with other colleges as well?
Yes,
yep.
And across the country, really.
Well, and Middlesex, as in so many other ways, is right out there doing the right thing.
That's right.
Outstanding. So if I were a homeschool mom in Bedford, how would I make a connection to this program if I had children who were...
Yes, well, we have hundreds of homeschool students that come to campus at on our Bedford campus primarily for dual enrollment courses. So the way it works is that any student that's interested, if they're at Bedford High School, they need to meet a GPA requirement, and it's a 2.0 or higher, and they need to have permission of both their principal, guidance counselor, and parent. The same thing with a homeschool student. They would need to have permission from their homeschool advisor, and they need to make sure that the course meets their graduation requirement. And then they can come right on campus. We have students as young as 14 on campus taking courses.
Really?
Yes, yeah.
Wow. Now, this is an exclusive for Bedford High School. It's for all the schools in this area.
That's right. We have lots of partnerships. We have a partnership with Lowell High School, Bedford, Burlington, Billerica, next year, Groton Dunstable. Next year we're adding some additional, along with our technical high schools, Greater Lowell Technical High School, Minuteman Technical High School.
Oh, the tech schools can do it too?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's so good.
Is it really? Thank you for doing this for so many different kinds of reasons. So what would a typical student's day be like? So they go to Bedford High School as if they did, and they know whether it's a day one or day two. They have an unusual and hard for me to accomplish, or hard for me to comprehend, day, figuring out what day it is. And they know what day it is, and they know what they're supposed to be doing. So they just go to their homeroom, and do they do this in what's called X block, or is this integrated into the...
The nice thing about dual enrollment is that each high school schedule, whether it's a rotating schedule, a block schedule, Middlesex works with the high school to come up with a schedule that's already in alignment with the way they've scheduled student coursework. So, for example, if an English Composition 1 course is being offered at the high school, it's during their schedule, their time.
Oh, okay.
So students are attending, and dual enrollment is just that. They're duly enrolled so that they're earning high school credit for their high school graduation completion criteria, and they're earning college credit and developing an MCC transcript for transfer.
Okay, so if the, now backing up a small step, if that student goes to the English composition class, they wouldn't necessarily then also take a Bedford High School composition class. The one would stand in place
they'd
of the
take
other.
Middle
That's
place.
Right.
That's good.
That's right, yep.
Now, so you're doing it at Groton Dunstable High School?
Yes, yep.
Okay, now how about other schools around that want to send students over to take classes? Is that open to all the...
It is, as long as they meet the criteria. And I think the other thing is that and that they've worked with their high school guidance counselor to make sure that the courses that they're taking are meeting not only the high school standards and criteria, but also are in alignment with what the student needs as far as their math, reading, writing, and that kind of thing. But we offer a full complement. And for some students, that are ready to extend their learning, especially a student that's already, let's say for example, exceeded their math requirement and they're ready for a higher level math, it's a great option to come to campus and take the courses that will help them better prepare for college.
Ralph, well, it's a whole new world.
Well, I think just the fact just the fact that you can get half your college done before even going off to college, okay, that's a big savings right there.
It is. It's tuition, a very big savings. Yeah, and there
well,
is
what
a
is
saving.
The tuition about for taking? Did they pay tuition at Bedford High, or those, how's that work
they
out?
Do. And Middlesex offers dual enrollment students a reduced tuition rate, which is $87 a credit. So almost each course is around $261 for a three-credit course, which is a significant savings.
A great bargain.
Yes, it
wow.
is.
Wow.
A
great bargain.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And even a student who is looking to go to a school out of state or a school that isn't Middlesex has, I would guess, a leg up in the admission process.
They do. In many cases, students have been able to demonstrate their ability and that they're capable of handling the rigor of a college-level course, and it can really help students demonstrate to colleges that they're interested in attending that they can do the work and they're prepared. And I think the other thing is that's nice about it is that students have a chance to really try the college experience on and navigate all of the resources that are available to them as well. For example, we have tutoring. We have all kinds of research databases in the library. And any student, even a dual enrollment student on their campus, if they're taking it at Bedford High School or they're coming to Middlesex, they are our students. So all of the facilities on campus are available to those students as well.
I think this. No, I actually.
Can I go have some more children? Maybe
actually,
not. Maybe that's not a good idea.
With this system, though, a student could get their master's degree in just 4 years,
right,
very easily.
We've had high school students graduate with an associate's degree, so
from high school.
High school. So,
oh,
and they've been able to move on and move forward. And in some cases, students have come back to share with us that when they landed on the college campus where they had decided to attend after high school, having taken dual enrollment courses, it really opened up opportunities for them to explore different fields of interest because they had already taken their general education courses.
Or when they finally, just after graduating from high school, they'll hit college with their wheels spinning.
That's
I mean,
right.
They'll be raring to go.
That's
this is fantastic.
That's outstanding. Yeah. So do you have a favorite story about a student that you'd like to share? Now, just not like putting anybody on the spot.
I just think so many of the students find their way, and sometimes for students they're not sure about what's next for them as they're navigating the high school. There's a lot of pressure on high school students, and I think the nice part about dual enrollment is they have a chance in a very safe environment in their own high school to start to explore study and how digging deep into college level courses can really open up a world of interest for them. And some students start at their high school taking courses and then decide to come to campus their senior year. And I think that's nice too because they've had a chance to earn some credit and then come to campus and really use all the resources. So I would say that's true for most of our students.
Wow, then they're in a whole nother environment and a whole focus group, wow.
Well, and you know what this means. We have to get some Bedford dual enrollment students in to tell what the story is from their perspective.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Another program, absolutely.
That's a great idea.
No, it would be really good. Mm-hmm. You know, the one thing that's always troubled me growing up in Bedford and teaching in Bedford and just being in town the whole time, there was always a separation. Middlesex was up there, VA was over there, and Bedford was here, and the airport was over there. I think this bringing the community together is just fantastic, mm-hmm, and I just keep promoting that kind of stuff.
It is. It's a wonderful partnership, I think, across the Commonwealth. And the other thing I just wanted to mention is that the Commonwealth of Massachusetts does have some funding for students. So if coming to the college or taking college courses at Bedford High School were a problem for a student, there is some scholarship funding as well.
Wow.
So there's a real commitment in this state to help students, and I think the other commitment to that in all of our community colleges is to help to reduce student debt. There are a lot of students that take on a lot of debt in going to college, and this helps to reduce that as well.
I was at a meeting just last night at MIT, and there was a person talking about, he was from Tennessee, and there are schools in Tennessee that aren't even on the radar screen of colleges, but yet there are some very bright students coming out of those places. I mean, this is an opportunity to kind of bring that link together. Mm-hmm. I hope this model gets replicated in other community colleges and other states.
Yep, and it is. It is. It's a really, there's a big movement, and to help students really use their time wisely. Some students end up in their senior year not having as many courses left to take. They've met a lot of the requirements. So dual enrollment courses give students an opportunity to really continue their learning and, you know, to earn that credit up front and early on, and hopefully.
And not be bored stiff to not get into that senior nuttiness.
Yes, right.
Oops. Yeah. Or graduate from Bedford High, take 1 year of classes and finish their associates at Middlesex and then go right into a...
That's right.
And save a lot of money, right. Not there pay the huge tuition mm-hmm. in all these other colleges.
And we also encourage students to really use the summer as a semester. Mm-hmm. It's a great time to take a course. It's a great time. They have a lot less on their plates, so more time to focus in on a course of high interest.
Great. Summer work is good.
Well, we often say here on Bedford Common that big Bedford is great, and this is just another big event in Bedford.
I think it's a wonderful resource.
Absolutely outstanding. Thank you so very much.
Thank you for having me.
And there will be a little bit more about Middlesex Community College coming along, so stay tuned.